I would request Professor P.C. Joshi, our Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor of the University of Delhi, to deliver his keynote address.
I'm very glad that the Department of Anthropology has been able to gather such a large gathering, such a large galaxy of people from all over India, all over world. And as far as I can see on my screen, 358 people are right now associated with us on the webinar, and many more must be looking at the Facebook Live. So we have really a very large group of anthropologists and other associates who are joining us on this webinar. Now, the topic of this webinar is, of course, related to COVID-19. And I would like to give a brief genesis of this webinar. Like P.R. Mandal said, it's not me, but it is a collective kind of a wish of, I think, all the faculty members. You all remember, in the month of May, we organized a Research Scholars webinar entitled Recent Advances in Anthropology, which was a tremendous success. And at the end of it, we all delivered, and I particularly wish that we should also have an intensive discussions involving our faculty members on this particular topic, because I am convinced from the very beginning that COVID-19 is an anthropological problem. COVID-19 is something where anthropologists have to play a very, very crucial role. And if you look around the discussions that are going on YouTube and other platforms, anthropologists are playing a very, very important role in delivering about COVID-19. Now, I would like to start by mentioning our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi in his last address to the nation. And he underscored and highlighted a very important point. And the point was that he requested people not to be careless, because we are observing in our neighborhood, in other places, that people are actually careless. People are not wearing masks. People are not maintaining distance that is required. People are taking risks. So these are the problems. Now, these problems cannot be solved by any doctor of the world. The director of All India Institute of Medical Sciences can give us a lot of lectures, can explain to us the course of this particular virus and what is going to have, what are the epidemiological projections. But when it comes to why people are not wearing masks, why people are not careful, I think it is the social scientist. And within the social scientist, since anthropology claims to study human behavior in holistic manner, I think anthropologists have to play a very, very important role at this juncture. Now, I would like to start by saying that handling of disease is science as well as art. And in medical anthropology particularly, we differentiate between disease and illness. Disease is the clinical aspect of it, and illness is, I would say, that the experiential aspect of it, or social aspect of it, or cultural. When we now dissect COVID-19 pandemic, so we can see these two dimensions. There is a clinical dimension to this COVID-19. People are having symptoms. But at the clinical front, what has happened is that we have not discovered any medicine, any treatment for it. And secondly, we have also not yet come out any vaccine. So the situation of COVID-19, to my mind, is like HIV/AIDS, where we have to solely or mostly rely on social and cultural aspect of disease and try to intervene in the human behavior so that we prevent it from spreading to others. Of course, by means of having right behavior, by means of having right kind of demeanor, by means of taking all the precautions that are required, we can protect ourselves from this particular disease. And that is possible. So therefore, I would say, if I have to define COVID-19, I would say COVID-19 is a social disease. It is a social disease because it has primarily social aspect. Its treatment and its management, its prevention is all social. So it has a large social and cultural component. And for that matter, I think anthropologists will have to play a very, very important role. And I think this particular webinar hosted by the Department of Anthropology, where we are involving not only the Faculty of Anthropology Department, but also, I think, galaxy of experts from outside is a step in right direction. And this should actually not only be a kind of feast for thought, but I think this particular webinar should stimulate other senior and junior anthropologists who would definitely like to take the messages take the lead from this webinar further and work on those leads and do research and come out with what is required from social scientists in general and what is required from anthropologists in particular. Now, first of all, we as anthropologists can contribute a lot. Number one, our framework or our perspective is holistic. We need to understand COVID-19 from holistic perspective. There is, of course, definitely a need for understanding human behavior, but I think anthropologists can also contribute meaningfully by means of its tools and technology available with physical anthropology to understand the behavior of this virus and how the behavior of this virus in connection with the populations or in terms of population genetics is behaving. I think that is also something why certain group of people are more susceptible to tolerate this, why some are not so susceptible. We are seeing that there is a variable prevalence that we can see in India. And this is something which is a very, very challenging physical anthropological topic. And as far as the social anthropology is concerned, of course, we need to understand why people do what they do. And we have to go deeper into their behavior to understand what makes them take the risk that is so serious. One thing very, very good about this particular virus, I must say in the beginning, is that it has a very low mortality rate. Although it spreads very fast, but it has not a very high mortality rate. So unlike MERS, you know, Middle Eastern one, where the mortality rate was nearly 50%, here the mortality rate is around 1%, you know, if you look into the situation, or less than 1%. So majority of people who are going to be affected by COVID-19 are going to be safe, and only a few among them, I think 1% among them, would have the danger of mortality. So therefore, there is also unnecessary panic that is being created in the society, that has been created by social media, sometimes by all kinds of projections, which again, I think anthropologists have to play a role in looking at it. One thing that is very important with respect to COVID-19 is taking the right knowledge to the people. There are all kinds of rumors that are there. There are all kinds of misinformations that is there. We'll talk about them later on. But anthropologists can also play a very important role in framing the right message and also identifying the right channel so that message reaches across. Now, there are scientifically valid messages, there are scientifically validated messages which exist in air, but they are not reaching the people through the right channels, and therefore what is happening is that we see all kinds of problems that is emerging. Finally, I think anthropologists are also very much suitable to devise intervention strategy, which would be effective. And these are, I think, three roles that anthropologists need to play. My topic is social and behavioral aspect of COVID-19. And therefore, I would like to talk about social or behavioral aspects. As I told you, that to me, COVID-19 so far is a social disease. And therefore, its social and behavioral aspects or social and behavioral dimension is very crucial, very important if we have to manage, if we have to prevent, and if we have to fight with this COVID-19. First thing that we, I think, as anthropologists need to discuss about what is being talked as social distance. I think coronavirus has made this particular term, social distance, a very, very popular term. Right from international galaxy of leaders to Indian leaders to experts, everybody is talking of social distance. But I think I have been talking again, and I'll take a few minutes to debate this particular point. Social distance in Indian context is a very contentious term, because Indians are referred to by the famous French anthropologist Louis Dumont as Homo hierarchicus. So social distance and social distance with the help of that people maintain with the help of ritual pollution and purity. People maintain social distance between different higher castes and lower castes. So these are ingrained in our society, and our society is fighting against these historical social distances which have been created by the caste system in our community. So what I'm trying to say is the use of term social distance in Indian context is very contentious. Actually, I would say that we should refrain from using a term social distance in India, because social distance in Indian context conveys hierarchy, conveys or reinforces the caste sentiments that we are after independence, we are deliberately trying to forget. So therefore, what is required is to maintain physical distance of 2 meters or 2 yards from each other so that the virus is not able to pass on from one person to another person. Now this virus, and I would like to just share with you the behavior of this COVID coronavirus, this particular virus. Somebody has said that this virus doesn't fly like eagle, but it flies like chicken. So it doesn't spread to a great distance. It can only take an infect in a shorter distance. If somebody who is coughing, if you are more than 2 meters from the person, if the person is not wearing mask, we are safe, because this virus will not travel very fast. So this we must understand. We must understand this particular principle. And I think we should maintain the safe distance. Now in Indian context, when we are talking of social distance, or I would say that I have qualified the statement that maintaining distance of 2 yards or more. But when we are talking of Indian context, then I think there are some cultural factors. There are some habits of Indians which come into play here. And in Indian context, keeping a distance of two yards from each other is a very, very difficult thing to achieve. We have seen whenever people have gone out and collected themselves, they have never maintained the distance that is required. And this is true of not only people who are educated, no, uneducated, or those who are poor. This is also true of people who are educated and who are rich. Now, there is something in the behavior of Indians which actually goes against this very basic principle of social distance. Now, Indians have the habit of touching each other's body. Now, this we don't mind. If somebody touches us, we don't mind. Now, we are not sensitive to other people's touch. You have seen that in buses. You have seen that when you are standing outside in the queue, that people do not refrain from touching each other. In fact, they would go very close to each other. And this is not considered as asocial in Indian context. And therefore, it is very difficult. It will take time for people to learn to be at a distance. And because people are not at a distance, what is happening is that people are getting affected by COVID-19 in a large number in Indian context. Second thing that is very, very essential for prevention of COVID-19, of course, is hand washing. Now, hand washing, like social, keeping physical distance, is also a new habit that most of Indians are going to learn. In India, we would look at things dirty when we are able to see it from our naked eyes. And we are not very sensitive as Indians. I'm not talking of everybody. I'm talking of a majority of Indians. We are not very sensitive to the fact that there could be microorganisms. So even if we used to think, and it's generally part of habit, even if you can wash our hand with water, that is sufficient. But now we have to learn a new way of washing our hands. And firstly, it involves washing our hand with soap. So we have to, as a habit, have to wash our hand with soap. And secondly, we have to keep that soap on our hands and, you know, for at least 21 seconds. So these two things are very, very crucial for Indians to learn. And many of us are learning it, but many of us are not learning it because our concept of dirt is related to not to the microorganisms, but related to something that can be physically seen with the naked eyes. And that is what we have to again, which is again a social challenge for Indian context. And this need to be changed, this particular need behavior. So all these, whether it's social distancing or the washing of hand, we need to change the habit by behavior change methodologies. Thirdly, what this is telling us at the social front, sanitization of the surfaces, sanitization of the clothes. People are becoming so panicked that they are washing their vegetables and fruits with detergents. So this has actually gone into the head of the people. People are very much afraid. And so this sanitization, so some of them are obsessed. They are becoming obsessed also. But this is another new habit that we as Indians are learning because of COVID pandemic. A very important behavior that is required is not touching the T-zone on the face. Now, T-zone is actually the T like this. So we have that as a T. So we have to protect our mouths. We have to protect our nose. We have to protect our eyes from touch. Now, it is again a part of habit. It's a human habit also that we try to scratch. We try to, sometimes there are itchings and we touch our hand. We touch our hand inadvertently. Now, this is something has to be avoided. Now, to some extent, I think this can be avoided by wearing of a mask. So if you are wearing a mask and if you have covered our mouth and our nose, and also suppose we have covered with a glass our eyes, to a large extent, we can prevent corona to enter, because this is the main route that corona enters into our body, through our mouth, through our nose, and through our eyes. And if we can have a kind of screen in front of these three major sources of corona infection, then to a great extent, we can definitely prevent it. So this is another thing that we are learning. Then we are also learning the concept like quarantine. Quarantine means 40 days. And it came when there was a plague in Venice and the ships were in the dock for 40 days and they were isolated for 40 days. So therefore, it was called as quarantine, 40 days isolation. Now, this is something, isolation is a new word that we are learning, that how we can keep ourselves away from spreading the infection. And suppose we have cough, suppose we have sneezing, suppose we have fever, then we try to isolate ourselves. And because with respect to corona, one of the very strange thing is that large number of people are going to be asymptomatic. So they may not be exhibiting symptoms. And this is something very, very, very crucial with COVID-19. So we are learning about isolations. Now, as far as isolation is concerned, I think in India, two models are being followed. One model is compulsory quarantine. That is, suppose you have symptoms and then you will have to leave your home and go to the government facility and isolate yourself. Now, this has a lot of problems. We have seen in many places, people in Bihar, they have been, you know, put in places which were worse than the jails. And that is not the way of quarantine, that people are devoid of the basic amenities, basic facilities like water, toilets, food that is required by them. There is another strategy of isolation that I think I'm greatly supporter of is by Delhi government. In Delhi government, they are having a concept called home quarantine. Now, home quarantine is for the people who are not seriously ill. And if it's possible in their home that they have the facilities to isolate themselves. And I think in Delhi, it has been a very, very successful, I think, experiment. And we need to learn a lot. Of course, where it's a very small house and there is no facility for people to maintain isolation, to live separately, then of course we need to have some kind of a isolation outside or institutional isolation. But at that, institutional isolation should be so conducive to people that they feel comfortable. This is very, very important. Now, as far as Delhi is concerned, I think it was projected that Delhi will have a large number of people. But for the last 4 or 5 days, what I see in Delhi is that the number of cases are coming down from nearly 4,000. They have now come to, yesterday they were around 1,300 cases. So I think Delhi, maybe what is called as herd immunity, maybe we are achieving herd immunity in Delhi. So things are not so bad in some places. And some places are either reached their peak or reaching their peak. But the new places are coming up. So therefore, these principle of isolation, which is very crucial to management and prevention of a spread of COVID-19, has to be carefully seen. Now, miscommunication, you know, this is another social problem that happens. Now, if you remember when our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced at 8 o'clock in the night that from 12 o'clock onwards, there will be a complete lockdown and nobody will be allowed to go out and all those things. And then it led to a lot of panic. People became panicky because they were not told that you will be provided with basic amenities. So therefore, what we saw was what we never wanted to see. People went, rushed to the shops in large numbers and crowded around. So the very purpose of the lockdown was defeated on the very first day. So therefore, it is very, very important that communications are proper. Now in Delhi, again, what happened that sometimes some rumor came and thousands of daily wage laborers, they started having exodus to their families, which is 1,000 kilometers, 2,000 kilometers. So these kind of communications, I think in the time of such pandemic, we have to be very careful with the communication. We have to foresee what impact our words will have on people, how people are going to react. We have to foresee that. And keeping that in mind, we have to be very careful in what we are telling. Then we have rumors, a lot of rumors, because what happens is that coronavirus is a new thing for Indians, because even the last SARS, we were not much affected. So it went, you know, it remained into some areas, although it was also COVID, but it remained in a particular, confined to a particular area. Indians were not very much affected. But this time, it actually affected each and every one of us, except for maybe Lakshadweep and, you know, one or two very small places. I think it is there everywhere. It is there. So it has got a universal kind of a spread as far as India or maybe other places are also concerned. So what happens is that there is a fear of unknown. People don't know what is going to cause them because there is no understanding. Even the scientific community kept changing its views depending upon new evidences that were coming to fore. So what I'm saying is that this fear led to all kinds of rumors, and the rumor created panic among people. And therefore, not only that, people had to undergo stress and anxiety, but also they took certain actions which they should not have taken. And therefore, this happens. So therefore, it is very important that we should take care of looking at rumors, looking at misinformations, checking social media so that these rumors are stopped. We had this blame game. Blame game also a very important social problem. And this is a natural human behavior, very natural human behavior. When it came in China, this coronavirus came in China, they started blaming Africans in China. It started from China, Wuhan, everybody knows. But when it came in China, they started blaming Africans. So different people at different countries started blaming different communities. And that kind of a blame game was there, which was not based on any evidence, scientific evidence. But this is a human nature. This human nature, if we have some grudge against some particular group of people, some ethnic groups, we try to involve them. And, you know, they try to, I think this is a natural kind of thing. Indian context also, I must tell you that Indian context also, a particular group of, I think, Tablighi Jamaat was blamed in the beginning, and it was said that they are the ones who are solely responsible for this. And I think, fortunately, there was a very, very strong social campaign, and India came out of this particular kind of trend. And I think rightly so that India came out. Now, there is also the problem that we as anthropologists facing, the stigma that is there. Stigma attached to COVID-19. We have seen that people who were infected by this were, blamed. They were blamed, and people started being very harsh on them. We have heard that many doctors who were working for the help of corona patients, they were asked to, they were asked to vacate if they were in a rented room. So these kind of things were also happening. So stigma comes out of fear, of course, but this is also a challenge to social scientists. This is also a challenge to anthropologists. This is also a challenge to sociologists to understand, to analyze, and to go deeper into why a particular stigma is coming up, and also to devise strategies so that this stigma is minimized. And this can be done by means of a sustained communication approach and talking to people, understanding them. We can definitely reduce the harm effect of this. With the stigma, what we have seen all over the world, in India is not an exception, is that people had a lot of problem in cremating their deaths. People have a lot of problems in burying their deaths. So last rites is something which I think is a right of a person to get a decent cremation, to get a decent burial. But there is so much of fear. There is so much of fear and stigma of this disease that at this front, many problems were faced, not only in India, but everywhere in the world. And I think as a sane human society, it is our duty that people who have departed are given a decent last rites. And here, I think anthropologists have to play a very, very important role. Of course, we have to also be careful that the virus is not spreading to others, because with respect to the Ebola virus, especially in African countries, there was a problem because the dead needed to be washed. And because of the practice of that dead needed to be washed, it spread to other people. So I'm not saying that we should not take precautions, but we must understand the behavior of coronavirus, and then appropriately we should take preventive measures and give decent burial or decent cremation to the victims, those who have died. Another thing that that happened, and it again should not have happened, is the panic buying that resulted in. Panic buying, actually, not only that, it created a situation that many people were deprived of essential things that they needed. But for example, in America, because people had, they were diabetic, they bought insulin in large number, and then many people who were diabetic could not get insulin. This also happens. And in panic buying, people are irrational and they hoard things. In America, I remember there was this garbage project, very famous garbage project in America, which was at the time of depression. So these garbage project people would analyze the garbage, and they found when there is a scarcity, people waste more when there is scarcity. So this hoarding behavior is an irrational behavior, and hoarding behavior will, of course, suppose I am a diabetic and I need insulin, and I hoard insulin because I don't know whether tomorrow I'm going to get insulin or not. So how do I hoard them? Whatever insulin is available, I'll buy them. Suppose there are 50 vials of it, I'll buy 50 vials of it so that I should be safe. But what will happen is that out of these 50 vials, I think 20 vials will have passed their expiry, and they will all go waste. So this is what happens. Suppose you buy tomatoes in tons, because you know that tomatoes are not going to come. So few you'll definitely eat, but rest of them, you have to throw them out. So this is what happens, that this is another behavior that is very crucial at the time of crisis that people engendered, and which is counterproductive as far as the society is concerned. Then there is an impact of COVID-19 on the health system. Now, what has happened is that because it has become a top priority, everybody is engaged in COVID-19 management, COVID-19 treatment. Most of the beds are occupied by people. But what about normal people, you know, normal people who need medical attention? People are getting heart attack, people are getting a stroke, people need all kinds of orthopedic treatments. So what is happening is because of COVID-19, there is a immense pressure on the health system. And therefore, many people who are non-corona critical patients are really finding it very, very difficult to the management of their condition. Now, in Indian context, I as I told you, as a country, we have been managing it, I think, very, very nicely, looking at the complexities, looking at the size of the population that we have. In fact, the mortality rate in Indian context is very, very encouraging, and it is far better than many other countries. And this is something. Now, in Indian context also, I would like to talk of two models. And these two models, I think, are going to be discussed and debated in future. One is the Kerala model. Now, Kerala model was considered to be a very, very good model to handle this pandemic. Of course, incidentally, the first case of corona came from Kerala. But Kerala handled it. And perhaps Kerala, being a very, very developed state of India, because the health indicators of Kerala are at par with any of the developed country of the world. So it's a very, very developed, it is a very, very educated state. And also, I think it has got a very strong health system in place for a very, very long time. I think right from the time of the kingdom of Travancore, that Kerala had a very, very strong health system. And this strong health system now came very handy when they had to handle corona epidemic. And I think Delhi, again, I would like to reiterate, I have told you before, I think Delhi is also able to manage this. And today, I'm very happy to tell you that large number of beds, corona beds, including, you know, ventilators are empty, and there is a space for people if they are critical. So this is a very, very, I think, a good management that these two places have shown. And I think they are going to become the example in the coming days. So I think Delhi, again, I would say that I think Delhi, because they followed home quarantine, I think they were able to better manage. What is going to be the social impact of corona on us, or what is going to be the enduring effect of it? Now, as I said, that COVID-19 is a kind of a benchmark. COVID-19, people are saying, you know, like I remember one of our research scholars said, you know, BC and AC. You know, BC is before corona and AC is after corona. So what is going to be the AC or after corona kind of a society? I think one thing that corona is going to do and has done is that I think we are going to see a transformation, major transformation in our greeting behavior. You must remember that many people shifted to namaste style of greeting. In America, in Europe, they shifted to namaste style of greeting and left the handshake greeting. Now, in the world, greetings are of different kind, but most of the majority of the greetings involve close body contact, close facial contact. And I think these close body contact, close facial contact kind of greetings in AC or after corona are going to change, and we are going to see major transformation in the greeting behavior of the people. Secondly, I think all over the world, and in India in particular, we are going to see change in personal hygiene. The personal hygiene is going to become part of the habit of Indians. And of course, linked to personal hygiene are that there are going to be reduction in the number of gastrointestinal diseases, reduction in maybe typhoid cases. So there would be these consequences that we can see. Then I think Indians are going to also learn sanitization. This is going to again become part of Indian habit. Disinfection and sanitization is also going to remain with us as a part of our habit. I think Indians were not very, very careful about public coughing and public sneezing. And I think nobody now coughs publicly. Nobody now sneezes publicly. And I think we are going to learn this lesson as well, that we will not be coughing or sneezing in publicly in the post-COVID or after COVID period. I think in our behavior, buying behavior, we have, got a very bad habit of buying in bulk. So then there is going to be a change. I think we are going to buy more in future than what we were buying now. Then I think one more thing that is going to enter into our life is that we would be, I think in future, going to prefer more and more online interactions rather than face-to-face interactions. So face-to-face interaction is also going to be replaced to a large extent in future by online interactions. So things like Skype, things like Zoom, things like WhatsApp, they are going to be used more and more by people. And many people are going to be obsessed with physical meeting, and I think they would be preferring meeting digitally. This is also going to increase, because 5 months ago, 4 months ago, I had never heard of Zoom. Now, Zoom is a household term. Everybody is talking of Zoom now. Then I think what has happened during the lockdown, many people have been forced to stay at home. Now, I remember my colleague Avitoli was saying that she is spending quality time with her children. I think many of us, many of the parents, they got a chance to spend quality of time with their children. So as far as the parenting is concerned, definitely this parenting has improved in this COVID period because of lockdown, because people were forced to stay at home. But secondly, I think what has happened, because men in particular were forced to stay in the home, and many of them, to kill their time, went into kitchen and started contributing to, I think, cooking of meal. So I think this gender equality, if there is an index of gender equality, I think that has increased. And there is more as far as gender justice is concerned. Finally, I think I would like to say one more change that has happened is that we have become more rooted, more grounded to our own traditions, spices, our own tradition, medicines. There has been an increase in the sale of Ayurvedic products. Now, somebody should do a study, because people have become more and more dependent on traditional Ayush kind of medicines, Ayush kind of immunity boosters, and I think yoga has also become, so people have become more conscious of increasing their immunity, and in the process, many kinds of Ayurvedic products, I think their sale has increased manifold. And finally, I think online shopping is also going to be increasing after the COVID-19. I think these were some of the views that I had. I don't know how much time I have taken, but I enjoyed talking to you. Of course, it is not as good as talking to you directly, but all the same, I enjoyed talking to you, and I would like to thank the organizers and for this opportunity that they gave me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Joshi. Now you have got a brief glimpse of the vast store of knowledge which Professor Joshi has. Professor P.C. Joshi, who is presently the Pro-Vice-Chancellor of University of Delhi, is at the same time Professor of Anthropology, Social Anthropology in the Department of Anthropology, University of Delhi. He has worked on many facets of anthropology, has been in the advisory board of so many committees set up by the Government of India. He has had many collaborative projects in not only in the national bodies, but also with the world international bodies. He has authored 10 books and has published nearly 200 articles in journals of repute. Thank you so much, Professor Joshi, once again, for a very comprehensive and illuminating talk, which is very typical of you.